This is the David Feldman Radio Network.
Joining us is the founder and treasurer of the Blue America PAC, and he writes the Down with Tyranny blog, which is a must-read, Howie Klein. We have some time today to talk about Bernie, and I want to get to him in a second, because I have endorsed Bernie, finally, on the show, Howie Klein.
Oh, great. We endorsed Bernie also at Blue America. It's the first time we've ever endorsed a presidential candidate. Normally, we only endorse down ticket. Like, we're primarily about the House, but we sometimes endorse Senate candidates and occasionally others, but we've never endorsed a president before. This is the first time.
Very quickly, we've been doing these benefits entitled Keep Hillary Honest. We did one with John Fugelsang at QED, and then we did one at Union Hall, and we're going to keep doing them. And the purpose of the benefits, they were to keep Hillary honest. We figured...
Wait a minute. That doesn't make sense.
Yeah.
I mean, how could you keep someone honest if they're not honest? How about make her be honest?
Right. Well, it's changing. So I want to I need your advice. So we did two benefits, and we said, look, we all know Bernie's not going to win, but let's do these benefits so we can send him money to keep him going to the convention. And then all of a sudden... I woke up and said, no, this guy, what are you thinking? This guy should be president. So we're doing benefits for Bernie now. Very quickly, when you do a benefit, he's not taking super PAC money, right? So we have to donate this money as a individual contribution. Is that how it's done? I just want to make sure we're doing this right.
Well, first of all, tell me the amounts of money that we're talking about here.
Okay, so Alex Brazil, who produces this show, we raised $900 at the last benefit at Union Hall.
So when it's something, anything below, let's just say for the sake of argument, $5,400. Anything below that is no problem. Just donate it as an individual. If it looks like you're going to be raising more money than that, then there are other ways to do it, and there are very simple ways to do it.
Okay, very quickly, because I do want to get to, but this is important for people who are listening who might want to do what I'm doing, unless you live overseas, in which case you can't do anything.
Well, no, that isn't true. We get lots of money from overseas. It has to be, you have to be an American citizen. So in other words, American citizens who live overseas can donate, and they do.
Can they get money from foreigners?
No, you cannot get money from foreigners, whether you live in the United States or outside of the United States.
Okay.
So if you live in the U.S. but you're a foreigner, you can't contribute. If you're an American and you live in Hong Kong, you can contribute.
All right. So we're talking to Howie Klein, who writes the Down with Tyranny blog, and you've been in the record industry. You have a life beyond anybody can imagine, and you're the founder and treasurer of the Blue America PAC, which raises money for progressive candidates. So let me ask you what is legal and what is ethical. If I go to a theater and say, we want to do a benefit for Bernie Sanders, and the theater says, well, we don't care about Bernie Sanders, we care about our venue and making money, we want to keep all the drinks, you can have the door. Is that ethical? Am I still doing a benefit for Bernie Sanders if the door...
Yes, absolutely.
Let me make this clear to the listeners and to myself. So I do a benefit for Bernie Sanders, and I say tickets are $10. I keep the door. Now, if you order food and drink, that does not go to Bernie Sanders, and I am not breaking any laws, and that's not unethical.
Yes, that's what I would say. No, I have to tell you something. I'm not a lawyer. I'm just like this music guy. So if you want to, you know, really check it out, Blue America has a lawyer, and he'd be happy to tell you the information that you need. But I've been doing this for a long time, and I'm 100% certain, as a non-lawyer, that what you described is correct. As long as you give Bernie all of the money that's collected at the door, it's perfectly kosher.
Now the gray area.
Okay.
What if we spend $200 on Uber and a poster? Does that have to come out of our pocket, or can we deduct it off the top, or is that just a gray area that has to be resolved internally?
Well, good question. So I'll just for the sake of saying, I will tell you that Blue America actually does not take any expenses off the top. I've been told that I have to, and that what we're doing is technically not kosher, that we're supposed to take off the expenses, because if you don't take off the expenses, then you are, in fact, making a contribution to the candidate without reporting it. You see what I'm saying?
Okay.
Yeah. So if you want to be completely above board, you have to take off the expenses. Or you have to report those expenses as an in-kind contribution to the candidate.
Right. But then you start thinking, well, what are the expenses? And then, and again, this is what I'm learning because I've never done this before. At some point you realize, oh, this is a great way to get rich.
Well, then you, at that point, you're a Republican, so you're not earning anyway.
Right, right. And that's what so I just want to share this with you and the audience and what I'm learning and what I'm observing, that if the danger of this is you raise money and then you begin to say, hey, I can create a super PAC or a 501c3. This is my time and my energy. I should draw a salary. If I'm paying somebody to build a stage, and he's being paid for his time, I'm paying for a poster, why shouldn't I pay myself for my time? And why shouldn't I pay my family for their time and my mistress?
David, I will tell you that if you did that, you would be in sync with, I'm going to guess, 99% of the organizations that do this kind of collecting of money.
Right. I
know Blue America is the only one that doesn't do that. Right. We don't take salaries. We don't take expenses. We don't, if we go out to dinner, we pay for our own dinners. If we use an Uber to get to something, we pay for our own Uber. What we collect goes to the candidate, period.
Right.
And when people donate to our PAC, just specifically not the candidate, but to the PAC itself, that money is used 100% of it for the candidates. Nothing right. to any of us or to our organization. All of it goes to the candidate. We don't even, I shouldn't be saying this, but we don't even charge for postage. We, you know, yeah.
Right.
Okay. It's all our own.
Great. And I, when we get off the air, I'll speak to your lawyer. This was a conversation we've done, and then I'll move on. We've done two benefits. And
they definitely take salaries and everything.
Who does?
Oh, I see what you mean. You're using the verb move on.
Oh, right. I want to move on. I don't want to be move on, but I do want to make sure that we're doing this legally and ethically.
Right.
And I think the best way to do it is at the end of the evening to tell the audience, this is how much we raised, and show the check that's going to the candidate.
Well, the audience loves that. That's real participatory, and people love that. That's why we use those thermometers. If you check out the Blue America pages, we have these thermometers that show, like, if you put money in, the thermometer goes up. You can watch it in real time, and it's very exciting.
And very quickly, and I guess I'll check with your lawyer, if, say, Alex or I donate the proceeds to a candidate, there's a limit to how much I can donate, right? If I, you know, God forbid we raise $100,000 for Bernie,
You can donate $100,000 to Bernie, but you can't just do it the same way you would do it as if you were an individual. Individuals can only donate, for the sake of argument, $5,400 to Bernie.
For the entire year, or is that like per cycle, like primaries and then general?
For the cycle.
Okay.
And that includes the primary and the general, 5,400. If you give Bernie 5,400, he is only allowed to use 2,700 for the primary, and then the other money he has for the general. He can't use the general money for the primary.
Right. Okay. And then so like Alex, God forbid we start raising lots of money, Alex Brazil donates the max from one benefit, then I donate the max from another benefit. Is that ethical? That's not.
Yes, absolutely.
Right. So, and I tell the audience it'll be donated in my name, so you don't have to give me your Social Security. Correct.
Yeah, that's good. That's the end. Yeah, that's right. Makes it a lot easier. You know, one of the easiest ways to do this, by the way, is through Act Blue. That's why Act Blue is. Remember, my pack is called Blue America, and that's different from what I'm talking about now, which is called Act Blue.
Okay.
So Act Blue is like, all it does is one thing. It makes it easy and simple with just a couple of clicks to donate money to Democratic candidates. You can't do anything else with it. You can't buy popcorn with it. You can't donate money to Republicans. You can't donate to the Red Cross. It's strictly for Democratic candidates and Democratic organizations also.
And you specify the candidate in Act Blue.
Sorry?
And you specify the candidate.
Of course. Yes, there's a little box for every candidate. Okay. And they have they're close to having raised $1 billion.
And am I bundling if I have a show and people are giving?
Yes, kind of. You're bundling.
I'm a bundler.
It's not, you know, when Republicans think about bundling, they think about, you know, going to people and getting $50,000 checks from them and putting them all together. But what you're doing is similar to what Blue America does. We aggregate lots and lots of people who give $5 and $10 and $20, and in the end that starts adding up to real money.
Okay, this is a great crash course in campaign financing, and we will come back to this sometime in the future. But very quickly, Bernie does not take money from super PACs.
That's correct.
If I were devious, or if I wanted to give to Hillary, could I create a super PAC, the David Feldman?
You can just create a normal old PAC.
I could create a PAC.
Yeah, I mean, that's different from a super PAC, and it's different from what Bernie really, really hates. He calls it super PACs, and he hates them too. But what he really, really hates is this other entity where you can cover up who's getting the money. That's his objection, is when some millionaire or billionaire comes in and gives giant sums of money, and then their name isn't attached to the money, so no one knows where the money came from. That's what he gets freaked out about. He feels if someone wants to make a contribution, it has to be open to the public to see who's contributing. Like, for just as an example, Robert Mercer is the CEO of Renaissance Technologies, and he has given $30 million to Ted Cruz this year. $30 million. And, I mean, that's what we know about, because that's money that has gone into PACs and super PACs that divulge their contributors. But he may have given $100 million, for all we know, to other entities that are legal but totally unethical and that don't divulge where the money comes from. So, for example, if you were to go into, if you were a Republican and you wanted to give a large sum of money and you didn't want people to know, you could go to Karl Rove's organization, Crossroads, and tell them, okay, I want to give $100 million. And they could say, well, okay, we can take that, we can handle it for you. And then you would say to them, but we don't want anyone to know that we're giving it. And then, oh, okay, it's a good thing you said that, because then we have to do it in this special committee, which doesn't divulge. And you can't mix these committees. And then they do it that way. And believe me, millions and millions and millions of dollars are raised that way. I don't know this for sure, but I don't think Hillary is doing that. I think that's at least one thing she's not doing. Because I know, like, when Soros gave her $7 million last week, he put it into a super PAC that does divulge the names of the people. Now, Bernie doesn't take any money from any of this stuff. However, Even Bernie will accept money from PACs. He doesn't solicit it. He doesn't have his own super PAC. But, for example, the Nurses Union they've endorsed Bernie, and they have a PAC, and that's the way they collect their money. Now, I don't know for a fact that the Nurses Union is giving Bernie any money, but they are doing efforts on Bernie's behalf. And they're collecting money through their PAC, so it's not accepting money from a super PAC. It's not accepting secret money, but it's perfectly okay in the situation that Bernie has tried to create.
Okay, I'm curious here. So let's say I create David Feldman wants to rip off the political system PAC. That I want to get rich off the political system. So I create a PAC called Let's Make David Feldman Rich Off Democracy. That's the name of the PAC.
Okay.
Do I have to register that PAC with the FEC, the Federal Election Commission?
Absolutely.
Okay, I go to the FEC, and I guess Colbert kind of did something like this, but I'm not that familiar with it. So I create this political action committee, and it's registered with the FEC, and then I say to my listeners, send me money so I can get rich off democracy, and they start sending me money, right? Can I pay?
Yeah.
Right?
Yes.
Because I want to get rich. And then I start...
Well, I don't think the FEC will. You have to tell the FEC what the PAC is all about. You have to tell them why you're creating a PAC and what it's for. And I think if you told them that it was for you to make yourself rich, they would reject your application.
Oh, so you have to apply.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, yeah, you have to tell them that you're. Yeah, I mean, you have to apply. That's right. I don't think they put it in those terms, but that's what it amounts to.
And then they grant me. Permission to form this PAC, and then
right. I mean, they don't ever say no to anybody, but the thing is that a political action committee that is doing something that's not political, that's they you wouldn't go to the FEC because it's not about elections, and if you just go to the FEC and say, look, I just want to rob people, they're going to say no, you can't do that.
Okay, so I want to draw attention to toenail fungus. I feel like there's not enough discussion about toenail fungus in our political discourse. So I create this PAC, and then...
No, what you would do is you'd have to register as a lobbyist, and then you could lobby members of Congress about toenail fungus.
I couldn't solicit donations from my...
You could, but then they're going to say, "Well, what are you going to do? What are you going to do with the donations?"
I'm going to pay my wife and kids a salary, and maybe take.
What are they going to do? What are your wife and kids going to do?
Well, they're going to subscribe to magazines that I like to read, and
the answer is no. You can't go away.
I'm being absolutely serious here. I know it's.
You can lie. And you tell them that you're going to, donate the money to candidates, or you're going to lobby candidates. So, there are things you can do, but I haven't really thought these things through. I have a lot of things in my mind, and this isn't one of them.
I know. I'm just because I do think this is how Karl Rove makes all his money. I think he gets.
Well, he doesn't do it like that. Karl Rove does something else. He pays himself a salary, as do. Some of the good people who are doing this. So there are lots of PACs on the Democratic side, and lots of people are collecting money on the Democratic side. And what I told you, I'm not joking. I mean, I'm not making it up. I as far as I know, the only organization that collects money for candidates, the only one that I know of, and doesn't pay anybody and doesn't take out any expenses and doesn't make any kind of profit off it in any way at all, is Blue America. I think we're the only ones. Everybody else, they might take a small percentage, they might pay salaries to their staff. I mean, some people put me down for it, by the way. And they say, you're making everybody work and you're not paying them. Is that right? Are you a slave master? But the reality is everyone is a volunteer, and everyone knows what they're doing, and everyone is committed to the progressive values that we're trying to promote, and that's what it is.
And if
no one has to show up at 5 in the afternoon and work all night. Also, people do it on their own time.
Right.
And I don't have any expectations that anyone is going to kill themselves trying to do the work. On the other hand, if I was paying them a salary, I would expect them to kill themselves.
Right. That's because you got rich in the record industry running...
Where we all kill ourselves by working.
Yes. And so now you can devote your time to progressive causes. All right.
Yes. But I have two partners and some other volunteers also who are not wealthy.
Right. And if people want to donate to the Blue America PAC, how do they do that?
Well, there are a lot of ways to do it. And if you go to Google and you put in Blue America PAC, you will find it that way. If you go to my blog, downwithtyranny.com, downwithtyranny.com, on the upper right-hand corner, there's a beautiful blue bar, and it says Blue America. And if you hit that bar, you get to a list of our House candidates. And that's our main page. We have a page for Senate candidates. We have a page for, we have several pages for Bernie. We have one page that is just for Bernie and for anyone running for Congress who has endorsed Bernie. So that's a separate page, and it's just for Bernie and people who have endorsed Bernie and who are running on his platform.
Right.
So, in other words, there's some crazy guy in New England who endorsed Bernie, a guy named Sean, what's his name? I think it's Sean O'Connor or something like that. Sean O something. He endorsed Bernie, but he's talking about things like raising the retirement age. So we don't include someone like that on the page. That he's obviously just doing this as an opportunist, trying to get money from people who like Bernie. So we're careful about that, and we check out everybody and make sure that they're for real.
Okay, I'm going to be checking in with you a lot through the election season, and I'm going to see what happens with these benefits for Bernie. And we're going to have a long conversation with John Fugelsang, whose show you should do on Sirius, by the way, if you have time.
I would be happy to. I had dinner with John. Alan Grayson brought us together. So I met him. I don't know if he remembers me or not, but I thought he was a great guy and very, very funny. I have a question for you, though.
Yes.
Do you do these things in just one place, or do you go around the country doing them?
We're going around the country doing them.
You should definitely check with me because they're a local candidate. So, for example, were you to do one in the South New Jersey area, like around Cherry Hill, say, around that area, I would say to you, oh, well, why don't you have Alex Law come and say hello to the audience, because Alex is not only is he running for Congress, but he was one of the first people to endorse Bernie. And he is, when he goes out campaigning for himself, he's also handing out Bernie literature and urging people to vote for Bernie. So that would be a good thing. And there, we have people like that all over the country. So when you do these things, if you can't have Bernie along, you might want to have one of these other people come and be part of your event.
Well, we did one last Saturday night. We raised like $900 for Bernie at Union Hall on Union Street in Brooklyn.
Great.
Sound familiar? Who would you, if we go back to Union Hall, is there somebody you could, I would assume Jerry Nadler doesn't represent that part of Brooklyn.
He does represent part of Brooklyn. I'm not sure where Union Hall is,
okay.
But it doesn't matter. I mean, first of all, Jerry, if I remember correctly, has either endorsed Hillary or is staying neutral. He hasn't endorsed Bernie. The only members of Congress as of today, there's going to be something changing in that direction in the next few days, but as of today, the only members of Congress who have endorsed Bernie are Keith Ellison from Minneapolis,
yes,
and Raul Grijalva from Tucson, Arizona. So those two have endorsed Bernie, and then there are a lot of people who have endorsed Hillary. All of the bad Democrats, every one of them has endorsed Hillary, but some of the really good Democrats have also endorsed her. And then there are a lot of people who are neutral, who are saying basically I think Hillary is great. I think Bernie is great. I'll be happy to work with either one of them as long as we keep Donald Trump and Ted Cruz and Marco Rubio out of the White House. Let's go. And they don't want to make an endorsement. And they all say the same thing. They will endorse the day after the primary.
Right.
Whoever won.
Right. But they become super delegates, right?
As a way of assigning superdelegates, but automatic superdelegates are every member of Congress.
Right.
So every member of Congress, every member of the Senate, every former president, every former vice president, I think every former Democratic governor. The super PAC idea is to keep the party controlling the party establishment in control. So I think that it's changed from time to time, but I believe right now it's 1/5 of the delegates, so 20% of the delegates are superdelegates, and the idea being, they can sort of tamp down democracy. Like, in other words, if Bernie winds up with slightly more, in Iowa, it was a tie. So they won the same number of delegates, but she had all the superdelegates, so she's got more. In New Hampshire, where Bernie won by a landslide, he won a huge, gigantic victory, they have the same number of delegates because she got the superdelegates.
Right. If memory serves, in 1984, Walter Mondale got fewer popular votes than Gary Hart in the primaries, but because of the superdelegates, Walter Mondale was able to get the nomination in 84, Jimmy Carter's vice president. Does that sound familiar?
It sounds vaguely familiar, but I was in Afghanistan, so I don't remember.
You were in Afghanistan giving arms to our allies, Al-Qaeda, at the time, correct?
No.
Oh.
Well, actually, in 84...
We're not allowed to talk about the work you did?
No, I was back by 84, but I still don't remember.
Yeah, I'm worried that people are going to think I'm serious. So, very quickly, I'm name-dropping here, but people should know this. I'm flying out of Des Moines to go back to America, or New York, 2 weeks ago. I ran into Congressman Keith Ellison, the first Muslim ever to be in our Congress.
And, well, not exactly, but okay.
Well, Thomas Jefferson doesn't talk about it. Who was the other?
No. There are and have been others, but he's prominent and talks about it. So some of the others, like for example, Andre Carson, who is kind of a centrist Democrat from Indianapolis, he's a Muslim also, but he never says anything about it. Whereas Keith is, proud of who he is and is, doesn't try to hide it from anybody and, wants to use his position to educate people that Muslims aren't just a bunch of radical terrorists running around, but that regular, normal Americans like everybody else who have regular, normal jobs, whether it's being a congressman or a dentist or a carpenter.
Right. And he's a post-9/11 Muslim congressman. He got sent to Congress from Minnesota after 9/11.
Okay, but before that he was a state senator.
It was a big, it was a bold election for him to, after 9/11, for Minnesota. Anyway, so I walk up to him, I say, hey, I'm David Feldman, I host a radio show for Pacifica Radio, and I'm I'm friends with Howie Klein. He has a big smile, and when I mention your name, and I said to him, I'm having a tough time because, I know Howie's a big Bernie supporter. I said this to you last time we talked. I didn't say this to him. I said, but Howie's a kamikaze. Howie is willing to go down with the ship to elect Bernie, to nominate Bernie and have him lose the general election. I'm not. So I didn't call you a kamikaze, but I did say I just don't think...
Oh, I'm a kamikaze, don't worry.
Okay. But in an airport, you don't want to say kamikaze. So I said, I just don't think Bernie can win the general election. And Congressman Ellison, another big smile, he said, come on, man. Barack Hussein Obama... He won the job. And that kind of once I began to think, okay, is it possible that I could support Bernie and he could win. Is that possible? And I went home and I really did as much studying as I possibly could. And I read Down with Tyranny. And you have some Quinnipiac polls. Tell me, let's go over the general...
Quinnipiac polls. There's polling every week. I mean, that's when you said poll to me. I wasn't sure which one you meant. There was another one, a CBS poll, that came out over the weekend, and there have been polls and polls and polls, and all the polls show the same thing. There's never been in recent months of divergence from this. The polls show that Bernie will beat the Republicans with a much larger margin than Hillary can. They also show that Bernie will beat all the Republicans. Almost all the polls show that he'll beat all the Republicans, where some of the polls show that some of the Republicans will beat Hillary. So when you talk about electability, people say, well, the polls don't mean anything now. Well, they must mean something. They're not definitive, okay, fine, but they certainly show that Bernie is more liked. Now, how could that be? Well, I'll tell you exactly, because you're talking about a general election. You're not just talking about a Democratic primary. In a Democratic primary, Hillary is very well liked because she's a Democrat, and she's been a Democrat, and people associate her with her husband, and people know her, and they've never heard of Bernie, et cetera, et cetera. So among Democrats, she's very, very well liked, especially low-information Democrats. But once you move into the general, remember, about 27% of Americans are Democrats, self-identifying themselves as Democrats. About 24 or 5% of the country identify themselves as Republicans, a little less, I think. But 44% of the country identify themselves as independents. Well, guess what Bernie is? He's an independent. And there are people who like that. Now, if you identify as a Democrat, you may just poo-poo that. But the fact of the matter is, that means something to a lot of people. So therefore, when you're polling a general election population, and you say Hillary against Rubio, invariably, Rubio is ahead. And then when you say Bernie against Rubio, I've never seen a poll where Rubio beat Bernie. Bernie beats Rubio every single time. Rubio beats Hillary every single time. So there is a difference there, and people will say, well, it's early, you know, it doesn't count. It does count.
Let me ask you some specific questions. Because I am supporting Bernie, but I've got some fears. So
I want to play devil's advocate, I know.
No, not devil's advocate. I know Bernie should be president. I know Ralph Nader should be president. But I try to think like an adult, and that's what gets me into trouble, and I end up voting for, you know, Hillary. And my big mistake, of course, was believing George W. Bush in the run-up to the war in Iraq. So let me ask you a couple questions. Trump versus Bernie in November. What do the polls show? Trump versus Bernie.
Polls, you know, not every poll is exactly the same in terms of numbers, but they are in terms of ratios. So the polls all show that, and this is just one-on-one, so there's no Bloomberg in this, just Bernie against Trump or Hillary against Trump. They will show Hillary beating Trump by 5 points. They will show Bernie beating Trump by around 12 points. So that is a gigantic difference. You know what kind of a difference that is? That's a difference of 3 or 4 Senate seats going to the Democrats, that kind of a margin. 3 or 4 extra Senate seats that Hillary wouldn't bring in for us.
And when did Bernie start winning in the hypothetical general in the polls? When did you notice this?
So, a couple of months ago, once people started knowing who he was, two things are happening. People are starting to know who Bernie is, people are starting to know who Trump is, and people are starting to know who Hillary is. The more people who start learning more about the kind of money that Hillary takes from bad interest groups, and the more people who see her doing... I mean, there's a reason why they didn't want to have her doing these debates. They knew very well what was going to happen, and it is what's happening. As she does more debates, and as more people see her, they get turned off to her. That's why she's losing her base of support.
Okay. Okay.
Let me
get to this in a second. These are issues that I have why I'm pessimistic. Voter suppression. Now, luckily for Bernie, the people who get suppressed the most are African Americans.
Well, that is not luckily for Bernie, because in a general election, if Bernie doesn't get a big and healthy African American vote, we will be looking at a President Trump or a President Cruz or a President Rubio.
Okay.
End of story.
Okay, I was making a joke, because I always, as a Jew, I always am amazed by the split between African Americans and Jews. How big a problem? I was going to ask you another question about vote. Let me first ask you about the voter suppression. The people you say about, what, 40% of Americans are independents? What percent?
44%.
44%. Do these people vote? Most people don't vote. Can they vote? Do they know how to vote? The people who
don't
vote.
I didn't mean Americans. I meant voters. 44% of registered voters are independents, are self-identified independents. Now that doesn't, so approximately half of them lean Republican and approximately half of them lean Democratic.
Okay, what about these people who, the untapped pool, the people who never vote, are they going to come out? Do they exist? We always hear about these people who have just thrown up their hands and don't.
Well, I mean, everyone said Trump is going to lose in Iowa and lose in New Hampshire because those are the people who support him. The fact of the matter is he did very well in Iowa and he won by a landslide in New Hampshire, which seems to prove that he can motivate those people to come out. It's the same with Bernie. I mean, you know, again, the exit polls show and other polling shows that Trump does not win among Republicans. Believe it or not, he is not winning among Republicans. He's only winning when independents come, you know, whether they change. It depends on each state, but some states have open primaries where anybody who wants can vote. Other states, you have to change your party registration, which people are doing that as well. And it's the same on the Bernie side. Bernie does well with Democrats, but he does way, way better with independents. So when independents are excited about Bernie and they vote in Democratic primaries, that's when Bernie's numbers go up.
All right, let's talk about African Americans. One of the blood libels against the black churches in California was they, along with the Mormons, got Proposition 8 passed, that gay marriage was outlawed in California because of African-American voters. We've since learned that wasn't true, right?
Well, it's partially true.
Well, I've been told that they're blaming African-Americans.
They did. They blamed African-Americans as one of the parties to that, and it's partially true. There were, you know, some very conservative African-American pastors who preached to their congregations to vote against it. Now they can't make them vote against it, and there are certainly plenty of African Americans, I would bet a majority, who voted for it. But there were some who voted against it.
Is there? And I'm always amazed by.
By the way, what about Hasidics?
I know.
You know that you think they're all in New York. There are plenty in L.A. and they're very, very as not as individuals, but as an organized force, they're very homophobic.
And they're child molesters. The bulk of in the Jewish religion, if you're going to get molested, it's from a Hasid. Because when you
I don't know anything about that.
Well, when you don't question authority, you're prone to male leadership. Anyway. African Americans and anti-Semitism, is that going to be a problem?
I you know what? I don't know. I was on a conference call today, and the conference call started. They're talking about the Supreme Court and what this organization can do to help the White House pass their nominee, and someone brought up. Well, they have inside information that it's going to be this guy, whatever his name is. Yeah. I can't pronounce his name. It's a guy. I think he was born in Kansas, but he has an Indian name, mm-hmm. and he's a Hindu, And he's on the appellate court of the Washington Circuit. So that's generally considered Supreme Court Junior. When a president wants to appoint someone to the Supreme Court later on in his term, he'll appoint him to the appellate court in Washington, and then that's where Supreme Court judges come from. So it's the second most powerful court in the country. And this guy is on that court. And when he took the oath of office, he swore on the Hindu version of the Bible. Now, to me, that sounds perfectly normal. It wouldn't bat an eyelash. I mean, so, okay, yes, and?
But he used all seven of his hands. It's a Vishnu joke. It's a Vishnu, sorry.
I get it.
Okay.
But to a crazy person like Marco Rubio or Ted Cruz, that is un-American, and they would freak out. I mean, it's hard for a normal person to think that way, but there are people who think that way. They're crazy, but they think that way.
And right, Ted Cruz, let Howie Klein, you're talking to David Feldman. You're in L.A. I'm in New York. We're both born in Brooklyn, and we're both delusional.
I'm not delusional, and there was not one Hindu in my elementary school or my high school. And if you don't believe me, ask Bernie Sanders. He went there too.
Okay, but what I'm saying is this about electing a Jewish president. I have two thoughts about this. Part of me thinks, I've noticed that when I talk to Republicans and I drop the Feldman bomb, I call it the F-bomb, because Feldman is Jewish. And when I say I'm Jewish to Republicans, they become terrified.
You could say Feldman, and then it's German, and they'll love you.
Yes. I have found that Republicans are terrified of me because I'm Jewish. And I have some theories as to why that is. But I think deep down inside, it's because they're afraid they're going to say something that's going to offend me. It's the same reason they laugh nervously around African Americans. But now when they get alone in a voting booth, I think they do something else. I think they hate Jews. They love Israel. They wish the Jews would all move to Israel and get the hell out of this country. We are filled with a lot of Christians and evangelicals who, when push comes to shove, how big a problem would they have?
Well, my experience is very different from yours, to tell you the truth. I don't find that at all. I don't find any anti-Semitism existing in my life, most of the people I know are non-Jewish, and I'm around their friends as well. I'm not saying there's no anti-Semitism. There is, but those are people who I think tend not to be part of the mainstream, and they don't vote. There are crazy right-wing anti-Semitic groups in Idaho. I don't think those people vote. But I think even among right-wing Republicans who are very religious, I think they are, at the very least, respectful of Judaism. And that's why you'll always hear someone like Ted Cruz or Marco Rubio saying the Judeo-Christian traditions. They never say Christian anymore. They always say, or unless they slip, they always say Judeo-Christian. I think that was really more of a problem for our parents and grandparents than it is anymore. Okay. And maybe I'm delusional, like you said, but I'm going by my experience.
Okay, I like to think you're right, but
I ran a big company with hundreds of people, and very few of them were Jewish. I shouldn't say very few of them, but it wasn't like there was 50% Jews. There were people of all religions, and most of the people reflected the population of the country, and they were Christians. And I never sensed any kind of anti-Semitism, even before I was president. I never sensed any.
Odd that a Jew running a business would.
No, I'm before I was the president. I was just another worker.
Oh, because I was saying your underlings are not going to show any sense.
No, they're not.
Okay, so all right. What about the fact that he's a socialist? I saw him with Charlie Rose, and Charlie, who is Jewish but doesn't wear it on his sleeve. The Inberg is underneath his sleeve. The Rose you can see, but the Inberg disappeared. He kept bringing up socialist, and I really began to dislike Charlie Rose because he kept
Well, I'm glad that that it's sort of getting out there and Bernie can dispel all the nonsense about it, because, you know, let's face it, there was never a moment when the Republicans weren't screaming socialist at FDR, and they never learned. He kept winning the most gigantic landslides in history, and they kept screaming socialist, and then he'd win another gigantic landslide. He won four of them, and they screamed socialist at him every time, and they even had proof. They had proof he was a socialist by what he was doing, and he won by bigger margins.
And now they're calling Barack Obama a socialist, and
they call everybody, every Democrat, a socialist. So people are sort of have become immune to it to some extent. But Barack Obama never calls himself a socialist. Bernie doesn't really let people call him a socialist. He always corrects people and says democratic socialist.
Right, right.
And, you know, basically, I don't know that it's the best phrasing to use. He'd probably be better off calling himself a New Deal Democrat, which is really what he is. But that's what he is. He's a New Deal Democrat. And people, that's why younger people are flocking to him. They understand exactly what he is, and that's what they want.
Younger people,
People under 40.
Say they have more faith in socialism than they do in capitalism.
Yeah.
So that's okay. So
when they say, when a lot of Americans, when they say socialism, they're not thinking of like Stalin and Marx. They're thinking of the post office, and right. They're thinking of you know, public roads. Remember, you know, if you want to drive from L.A. to San Diego now, you make a choice. You go this. You can go on a socialist road, which is free, or you could go on a capitalist road where you have to pay. You make it. You make that choice. Everyone has to make that choice when they want to drive between those two cities. You want to pay on the capitalist road, or you want to go free on the socialist road?
What do you do?
I've never been on a capitalist road.
That's a new phenomenon, by the way, where they charge extra. There are a couple of these new highways that are popping up. Okay.
Yeah.
What about gerrymandering? What about the fact?
Well, that doesn't affect the presidential election.
Well, it does, in that people who are going to vote for Hillary say, we're never going to get a Democratic Congress because of gerrymandering.
So, we're never going to get we're never going to get a Democratic Congress because of Steve Israel, Rahm Emanuel, Chris Van Hollen, and Nancy Pelosi. Once those people are gone, and they are, you know, they are getting gone, and we get someone who actually wants to win Congress back, the Democrats will win Congress in one cycle. One cycle, that's all it's going to take. One cycle. You put Keith Ellison in as the head of the DCCC, the Democratic Congressional Campaign Committee, you put him in today, and then the next president will have a Democratic Congress. You put Mark Pocan from Madison, Wisconsin, in as the head of the DCCC, you do it today. Next January, we have a Democratic Congress. It's that simple. Literally, I am not exaggerating. The members of Congress know I know more about this than almost anybody. And I will tell you, Steve Israel, Rahm Emanuel, Chris Van Hollen, Ben Ray Lujan, the imbecile they have in there now, they are so fearful of progressives that they would literally, and have been doing, rather see a Republican keep a seat then see a progressive win that seat, and they purposely go out and find Republicans and try to lure them into changing their party identification. In fact, I did a story on my blog today, which people should read. Steve Israel did an interview with a magazine in Nebraska, and he never imagined that anyone would ever see this except a few people in Nebraska, and he didn't care. And he was asked, this is the question he was asked. You recruited this guy, Brad Ashford. Brad Ashford was a conservative Republican state senator. And Steve Israel, the head of the DCCC at the time, recruited him to change his party identification and run as a Democrat. And this is something he does all the time. I mean, I'm just giving you one example, but he does this constantly. And Rahm Emanuel taught him to do it. He was the first one that was doing it. So Then the guy gets into Congress as a Democrat, and what did he do? He votes with the Republicans on everything. 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 The story that I was writing about was the Labor Department is trying to change the rules so that when people earn overtime, they can actually get paid overtime.
Mm-hmm.
Very simple thing. Who's going to be against that? Well, the Republicans are against it, but so is Brad Ashford and a couple of other Democrats. So that's what my story was about. But because of that, I started researching it, and I found this interview with Steve Israel. And the interviewer says to him, well, what do you think? You recruited this guy, and now he's voting with the Republicans on everything. And Steve Israel said, I don't care. It doesn't bother me. It doesn't make any difference. That's what he said, because that's what they believe. Do believe that.
Right. Do they believe that we have to win difficult seats, and so we have to run conservative Democrats in difficult seats, or do they believe in being conservative Democrats?
What you just said is what they say, but it's not the case. There's no empirical evidence of that. There's empirical evidence that's the opposite of that. Let's take our mutual friend, Alan Grayson. So Alan ran against a Republican in Orlando. There hadn't been a Democrat representing that area of Florida, of Central Florida, in decades and decades. I mean, there was one when Franklin Roosevelt was president, but that's how far back you would have to go to find a Democrat that represented that area that Alan decided to challenge a Republican in. So here's a Republican. So the DCCC says, you're too progressive, you're too liberal, you can't win this district, we're not going to support you. And instead they supported some slob who was really a Republican. His brother was the head of the Chamber of Commerce, and on every issue, he was with the Republicans. He was, you know, he was pro-choice, but other than that, he was with the Republicans on everything. He was anti-gay, he was raise the age on Social Security. He was just terrible. And that's who the DCCC thought was great. And Alan beat him. At which point the DCCC washed their hands in the district and they said, well, you can't win, goodbye. And they refused to support him. But Alan won, and he won by a lot.
So they have
no evidence of what they say. It's just their wishful thinking because they hate progressives so much.
Right. So you're saying that if the head of the DCCC was not Steve. He's no longer the head, but he's
pulling the strings still on, right, on a moron that Nancy put in there.
That if you had a genuine
Ray Lujan from New Mexico,
if you had a genuine progressive running the DCCC, we would have.
Well, it's not just a progressive. It's not like any random progressive. You have to have someone who knows what they're doing. That's why I singled out Keith Ellison and Mark Pocan. Those two guys both know what they're doing. They both want to win. They know how to do it.
What we're being told is that until the next census, we're not going to have congressional seats that look inviting to Democrats. And you're saying that's not true.
It's not true.
Okay.
There are numerically enough seats. The Democrats went from being about 80 seats up to being 60 some odd seats down. That's a huge swing. There's plenty of seats all across the country that are contestable. I wish there were more, and there could be more on the next census. It's possible that there'll be more, but there are enough now for the Democrats to win back the House. Not under Steve Israel, that will never happen.
Okay.
Not under Ben Ray Lujan, not under Rahm Emanuel or anyone like that. That will never happen.
Okay.
But it could happen if they recruited the right people. They're recruiting all the wrong people. They are literally out there recruiting Republicans.
So let's get back to the problem with Bernie. I'm voting for him, but these are issues. So we're not going to change the DCCC this election cycle, correct?
Most likely we are not.
If Bernie got the nomination, right? He gets the nomination. Could he then dictate to Nancy Pelosi, get rid of whoever you have running the DCCC? I want Keith Ellison. Does he have that? Then he becomes the de facto head of the Democratic Party if he's the nominee, right?
Well, he could ask her to do it. It's up to her. What he has to do is to dictate who the head of the DNC is. He picks the head of the DNC.
And that won't be Debbie Wasserman Schultz.
I wouldn't think so.
And he can get rid of her after the convention?
Yes.
Okay. So it is conceivable then that...
Yeah, I mean, it's that simple. If he wins the convention, he goes to Obama and says, I want her out today. And Obama would say, yes, well, let's get her out. If Hillary wins, she stays.
Okay. The guys like me who think they're adults are gradualists. And I saw that in the debate between Hillary and Bernie. And I really disliked that side of me. Hillary, when she talked about the ACA Obamacare and was defending it and saying to work with that instead of Medicare for All, I really began to dislike her. And I began to dislike the adult in me, because the ACA...
I don't know why you keep saying the adult in you.
Well, because that's what we get... I get convinced that, yes, Bernie's right and the socialists are right, but the adults, we have to avoid chaos and we have to do things slowly. And then when I hear Hillary saying, let's work on what Obama built, as opposed to what Bernie is saying, which is put the health insurance industry out of business, which has to be done. This has to be total war.
Wait a second. Yeah, who? What?
Bernie during what, the...
You're putting the health... You're putting who out of business?
Bernie said, and I agree, that the way to, that in order for you to have Medicare for All, you have to put the health insurance industry out of business.
Insurance industry, yes. You don't actually have to put them out of business. They still exist in England as well, but they're not a giant industry anymore. They'll be a much smaller industry serving a much smaller population. In other words, if you're getting national health insurance in England, there are some people that want to have private health insurance as well. So there is a health insurance industry. It's just not as big as it is here.
Okay. So what happens if Bernie gets the nomination and two things happen? One is he loses, then it's like McGovern and we'll never have a chance again. Or he gets elected and we don't have a Democratic Congress and he becomes the Jimmy Carter of the next generation, where people say, look, we gave it a try with Jimmy Carter. You want to go back to the years of Bernie Sanders? What if he's undermined the same way Tip O'Neill and Teddy Kennedy undermined Jimmy Carter?
You tell me that Hillary is not going to be undermined by the Republicans? Is that, you can't be saying that.
What?
That Hillary Clinton is not going to be undermined by the Republicans?
But at least...
They hate her more than life itself.
I know that, but... But she's not.
I hate Bernie. Do you know that in the last poll that I saw in Vermont among just Vermont Republicans? So this was a poll among Vermont Republicans. Who do you want to be the presidential nominee of the Republican Party? Bernie was tied for number one with Trump. Tied for number one among Republicans. No independents. No Democrats. Just Republicans. If Republicans can handle Bernie, I want to read you something by Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. I'll paraphrase it. He argued that incrementalism,
yes,
is the status quo co-opting every small change for its own purposes. That's why he opposed incrementalism, because that's exactly what happens. Bernie isn't saying he's coming into Congress and on January 18th he's going to institute the end of the insurance industry. That's not going to happen. I mean, it's not incrementalism what he's trying to do, but he has to do it in a responsible way, and he knows that, and he's going to. But if you don't aim for these things, remember, every single hard thing that happened in America, from the Declaration of Independence and the Revolutionary War and the Civil War and women getting the right to vote and African Americans getting the right to vote and Social Security and Medicare and the minimum wage, land-grant colleges, all of these things, they were all declared by the adults as impossible. It can never happen. It will never happen because conservatives will block it. And guess what? They did. They blocked it, and they blocked it, and they blocked it, and eventually we got them all. But if you don't fight for it, you're never going to get it. If someone would have said, and they did, Social Security, are you crazy? That's never going to get through. Are you nuts?
All right. I agree with you, and I agree with you about incrementalism, especially when it comes to health care, because Obamacare is the best Obama could do, but it's not really good enough. Okay, what about his age?
He's 4 years older than Hillary, right?
Yeah.
And 3 years older than Trump?
Okay. What about people who say that he, like Trump, is very good at critiquing the system, but he's not too big on details? Whereas Hillary, she knows how to get things done.
Well, she says she knows how to get things done, but please tell me what she's ever done. I'd like to hear something that she's done. Just one thing. Anything. I don't mean starting the disintegration of Libya. I mean something good that she's done. Something good she's done.
Well, you know, when she testified before the Benghazi hearing, I thought...
They grilled her and she answered the question. You should get like a little trophy for that. I'm happy she did good. I thought she did good. She hasn't done shit. What she does is she says that she knows how to get things done. Bernie has a record that goes back over 30 years. You want to see somebody who gets things done? You can look at his record as a mayor. You can look at his record as a congressman. And you can look at his record as a senator. And he's been getting things done. Even someone like John McCain has said that Bernie is one of the most effective legislators that he worked with, and admitted that without Bernie, they wouldn't have had all these reforms to the VA. I mean, Bernie wants more, but there's only so much you can do with Republicans. But it's not like Hillary is going to get any better. They're going to stonewall her as much as they can.
Right. I'm voting for him, and I'm endorsing him. And my listeners, if you're an incrementalist, a gradualist, or you think you're an adult, I strongly urge you to go to C-SPAN, the website, and look up some old speeches by Bernie Sanders. Go to YouTube and listen to him. And everything he says is right. The other thing is, then we'll wrap it up because you've been incredibly generous with your time. I wanted to ask you about Trump, but the one thing that is stunning to me is everything Bernie Sanders says, you weren't allowed to hear on corporate radio or corporate television. Everything that comes out of Bernie Sanders' mouth 4 years ago was relegated to Democracy Now! Or to some obscure internet radio program. He personally, along with the Occupy movement, has brought things center stage that the mainstream media wouldn't dare let anybody say. Right?
Absolutely right.
Corporate controlled media. He was talking about that, you know, talking about income inequality. This was something that wasn't on the table 4 years ago. That being said, did you see Donald Trump in the debate Saturday night? Now, I have to say this. I'm voting for Bernie Sanders, okay?
You have many times.
Yes, I'm voting for Bernie. I think it would be a disaster if Donald Trump got elected president. I think he's a disgraceful human being, but I now love him. After watching him...
He's a comedian, and you're a comedian, and you love him on that level.
And the way he just roughed up the Bush name, God bless him.
I wrote about that on my blog today.
Yes, yes. For him to repeat, as the audience booed, 9/11 happened on your brother's watch. And when the audience booed, he repeated it. And for him to make it settled law in the Republican Party that Iraq was a disaster... He deserves something, right?
Yes. Good. Thank you.
A thank you. And are you?
I thank him on Twitter all the time, and he reads Twitter, and I'm sure he's very happy to be thanked.
And as long as he doesn't become president, I will now love him. I think he's. Except for the fact that he's a horrible human being and wants. And do you honestly believe? Okay, I'm not going to defend him. He's a horrible human being. Do you want him to get the nomination? Do the Republicans deserve this? Are you frightful that he might get the nomination, or is this the fruits of their labor?
I am doing everything I can in my limited way to get him the nomination.
Why?
Because all polling shows he's the easiest to beat.
And they deserve him.
They deserve him. He's destroying their party.
What are the consequences? What are the consequences to the Republican Party a year from now if he...
Well, first of all, my dream scenario, so don't even go for a year from now, let's go to July. My dream scenario, the Republicans now have decided they can't keep him from winning. What they're trying to do is to make sure he doesn't win on the first ballot. So, in other words, he's going to march into Quicken Loan Arena in Cleveland with the most delegates. They know that, and there's nothing they're going to be able to do to keep that from happening. However, they'll do anything to keep him from getting 50%. Remember, they don't call them superdelegates, but they have superdelegates too, and none of them are going to be for Trump. They're very, very controlled. So they're going to, they don't like Ted Cruz either. The public establishment hates him. But he'll have a block of votes. Rubio will have votes. Jeb Bush will have some votes. That other fool from Ohio will have votes. So there'll be different people that have different votes. Plus, the Republicans are now pushing very, very hard to get some favorite son candidates so that they have a bunch of votes. Not that they can win anything. The idea is just to stop Trump from having 51%. That's all they're trying to do. And then what happens? Then they roll out Paul Ryan and say he is going to be the compromise candidate.
Right.
And then what happens? Well, I found out that the Republican Party has determined that there will be no guns allowed into the Quicken Loan Center, even though Ohio has a concealed carry law, even though there's no conceivable reason. I mean, the Republican philosophy is you're safer if everybody is armed. That way, if a bad guy comes, you shoot him.
Uh-huh.
Yet they're saying no guns are allowed in. However, people can bring in nitroglycerin. They can go to the bathroom and make bombs. There's all sorts of things that they can do. They could stab people. Paul Ryan insists that bow and arrows be allowed in public functions. Someone could bring a bow and arrow and shoot him in the head. You think I'm joking, I know, because you're a comedian. You think I'm being a comedian. But I'll tell you something. I am not joking. Paul Ryan passed two bills in his life. One of them is renamed the post office in his hometown. And the other bill was to some kind of a rebate on a tax for arrow shafts. It was something, because he hunts with a bow and arrow. And he literally passed a bill, which everyone was laughing at, but they went along with him, about arrow shafts. And that's what he cares about. And you are not allowed to go to any Paul Ryan functions with a gun. Now, Paul Ryan, just by the way, aside from being the speaker, is the single biggest recipient of legalistic bribes from the NRA serving in the House of Representatives today. So there are other people that got bigger bribes. They're not in the House today. He's in the House today. Boehner got bigger, but Boehner's not there anymore. So he got the most money of anybody. He is the NRA's go-to guy. They love him. No guns are allowed at any Paul Ryan functions. When he goes to do a town hall meeting, no one's allowed to have a gun. You are allowed to bring a bow and arrow, though.
Okay, I was going to wrap it up, but this is catnip. I went to a Tea Party rally in South Carolina to hear Ted Cruz. They auctioned off an AR-15. The company from Newtown, Connecticut, that made AR-15s had to relocate to South Carolina, and they held up an AR-15. The same pose the Texas police held up the Mannlicher car cano that they found with Oswald. They held it up, and it was the same pose, and we're auctioning this off, and the guy gave this impassioned speech about how South Carolina is so inviting to gun manufacturers. We had to leave. We could no longer make AR-15s after Newtown, and I thought, well, then why did I have to go through metal detectors here? You could not get into the Tea Party rally unless there were, you know, I was the magic wand checked me for weapons. And Ralph Nader said that at the NRA, you got to go through a metal detector at the NRA building.
I bet. Well, who knows better than these people how crazy they are.
Why? And are you writing about this?
All the time.
Why do they have metal detectors?
You know, I write about it all the time. I did a huge article about the Quicken Loan Center scandal of Republicans not being allowed. And by the end of the cycle, if this is playing out the way I think it is, and the Republicans look like they're going to try to foist Paul Ryan onto and to, you know, prevent Trump from getting the nomination, I will be publishing instructions for how to make a bomb on my blog.
Because
I want Republicans to kill each other. How subtle do I have to be?
Let me ask you this: who are the metal detector manufacturers? Shouldn't they be the enemy of the NRA? Shouldn't the NRA be the NRA? As I remember, after Timothy McVeigh used fertilizer to blow up that building in Oklahoma, the Muir building, or I forgot his name. But anyway, after Timothy McVeigh rented the Ryder truck and blew it up with fertilizer, there was a suggestion that you be able to put a tagant inside gunpowder and fertilizer so you could trace.
Yes, I remember that.
And the NRA blocked it. They said, no, you can't, no tagants in gunpowder, no tagants in fertilizer. The fertilizer bombs are protected by the Second Amendment. Well, doesn't it follow then that the NRA should be against metal detectors? If you're allowed to conceal carry in Arizona, then metal detectors should be against the law, right?
Well, I think they're thinking of it in terms of a principle. They're trying to say they have some kind of principle.
But it's
crazy. I mean, you know, I mean, what are we going to like psychoanalyze crazy people? They
no,
are
but
crazy.
I'm saying this should be this. So you're saying that there should be no metal detectors at I would assume Cleveland.
Yeah.
Doesn't have concealed carry laws, right?
No, it's Ohio. They do. They have a statewide concealed carry law. And what happened was the city of Cleveland said, okay, the state, you fine fellows in the state, you just do whatever you want to do, but in the city of Cleveland, there will be no concealed carry. And then the legislature passed, and the so-called moderate governor, Kasich, signed a bill saying that Cleveland has no right to make its own laws that override the state. And therefore, there is a concealed carry law in Cleveland.
So you're allowed
and yet
to carry,
still not allowing guns into the Republican convention. I guarantee you there will be pickets. There will be NRA and Republican people in front of that Republican convention picketing in anger because they're not allowed to bring guns in there. They should be able to drive tanks in there.
Oh, we have to revisit this.
Okay.
You didn't make that. It's been you've been on for like an hour 20. So you didn't make this clear. I didn't know that you're allowed to walk around Ohio with a concealed weapon.
Absolutely. You're allowed to go into a bar with a concealed weapon. You're allowed to get drunk with a concealed weapon in your pocket.
And yet the Republicans are denying Republicans the right to bring a loaded weapon into the. Okay, you didn't make. It's been a long interview. We have to revisit this. Howie Klein is the founder and treasurer of the Blue America PAC, and he is he writes the Down with Tyranny blog. And you've won me over with Bernie. Tell people what they can do either to help Trump get the Republican nomination, and or help Bernie become our next president.
Well, I suspect that not many of your listeners are Republicans, so they can't vote for Trump. I think the better way to do this is to vote for Bernie. So people should vote for Bernie. They should urge their relatives to vote for Bernie. They should learn about Bernie so that they can talk with their uncles and their cousins about Bernie. And if they have extra money, even $5 or $10, remember, Bernie is keeping up. Bernie is, I think, the fourth biggest fundraiser of all these Republicans and that establishment Democrat who are running. I think it's Jeb Bush number one, Hillary number two, Cruz number three, Bernie number four. So he's doing really well, but his average donation is $27. The average donation of the 100 richest families that are giving money to the super PACs of Cruz and Trump, not Trump, Cruz and Rubio and Hillary and Bush, the average donation, $1,900,000. That's the average. $1,900,000.
Give me that number again.
Bernie's average, $27.
Wait. You know, sometimes you throw things at me, and it'd be like the concealed carry laws in Ohio, and it just washes over me. The average donation to Bernie Sanders is how much?
$27.
The average donation to Jeb Bush is how much?
I don't know. I didn't say the average donation to Jeb Bush. I said the average donation of the 100 richest families.
Oh, okay.
Not the 100 richest families. I misspoke. The 100 biggest donors. So what am I basing this on? The magazine Politico has a list that came out where they list these are the 100 biggest donors. And this is how much they've donated. And the average was $1,900,000. All of that money going to these super PACs of these other candidates. Bernie doesn't get any of that money, zero.
The message I'm taking away from all this, there are a lot of messages, is vote for Bernie. If somebody tells you they're voting for Trump, encourage them. Right?
Yes. I would do.
Until the general election. But right now, if you're in a primary state, if you're listening to us where Trump is running and people
are... I never call him Trump. I call him Herr Trump.
That's the original spelling.
No, his actual name was Drumpf.
Oh, right.
But I don't want to confuse people.
Well, we'll talk to you next week. Thank you so much. You were very generous with your time, Howie.
All right.
Bye-bye.
This is the David Feldman Radio Network.
Are you enjoying today's show?
I know I am.
Well, there's a very simple way to say thank you, and that's by shopping at Amazon. Yes, that's right, Amazon. Make all your purchases at Amazon through the David Feldman Show website, and we'll get 6% of everything you purchase. It's a pretty good deal. Next time you want to buy something on Amazon, first go to the davidfeldmanshow.com. You'll see an Amazon prompt. Trust me, you won't miss it. Click on the Amazon prompt and then shop away. 6% of all your purchases go towards keeping this program commercial free. Ever wonder why something that really stinks is somehow really popular? All those views on YouTube, all those likes on Facebook, and all those followers on Twitter? Why? Why? Take it from me. If it stinks, then all those views, all those likes, all those followers, all those rave reviews,
were probably bought and paid for. Sadly, there are publicists out there who can provide authors, politicians, musicians, comedians, TV hosts, and podcasters with rave reviews on Amazon and iTunes, also non-existent fans and followers. That's because, unfortunately, the illusion of success often creates success. We all like a winner. It's human nature. So if you think something's popular, you check it out. It's wrong, dishonest, and makes it hard for the little guy without corporate funding to compete. It's a stupid game to play. I don't have time, I can't afford to play it, and if I did have the time and the money, I wouldn't. Okay, yes, I would. But that's besides the point. Look, this show should be more popular. I'm not saying it's the best. I believe it is, but I'm not saying it is. I know it's not for everyone, but it's pretty damn good. And it deserves to be heard. Heard by a lot more people. And I know you believe this because you're listening. There's so much crap out there, and so much of it is forced down your gullet by publicists who create the false illusion that it's popular. You and I can't do anything about that, but here's something we can do. Here's what I would like you to do. Please, please go to iTunes and give us a good review. If you don't want to write a review, then just press the number of stars you believe this show deserves. Personally, I would give it 6 stars. But they only allow 5. Taking the time to do just that will go a long way in helping me reach a larger audience. The David Feldman Show is slowly growing in popularity. Slowly. Each month, we add new subscribers. And we've done it entirely on our own. Well, not really. We've done it through you. Through your word of mouth. Thank you. You promote this show by listening, by giving us good reviews and telling your friends. I need to do this show, and I need you to keep listening, and I need you to help spread the word by going to iTunes and giving us a couple of stars or a nice review. We're not stuffing the ballot box here. I'm just asking you to promote this show the most honest way I know possible. This program, the people who appear on it, write on it, and listen to it deserve that much. Thank you for taking the time to listen, as well as taking the time to tell others about the David Feldman Show.